What's that?
Starts at 10.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, okay. The committee will come to order. All right. Thank you, Chairman Bernanke, for coming to our committee today to talk about the state of the economy. This is, you've been here a number of times, and we appreciate your time. We know your schedule is tight, so we'll proceed quickly so we can get you back on your schedule. Nothing is more critical to today's economy than restoring real job and business growth in America. Yet for almost 3 years, the U.S. economy has remained mired in a slow-growth, high-unemployment trap. The president and his party leaders say things are getting better. Yet we continue to hear from families and businesses in our districts who tell us this kind of talk is completely disconnected from reality. The fact is that this administration told a stimulus plan would keep unemployment from ever rising above 8%, that the economy would have grown at 4% last year. In reality, unemployment climbed as high as 10%, and today it stands at 8.5%. Worse, CBO confirmed just yesterday that it is projecting economic growth to remain sluggish and that the unemployment rate might hover near 9% through 2014. So the obvious question is, why did these policies fail? I think when you get out and talk to families and businesses, the answer becomes quite clear. The president's policies added hundreds of billions of dollars to our annual deficits. As a result, the explosive growth of our debt created tremendous uncertainty about our fiscal and our economic future. When government sows doubt about future tax rates, interest rates, and price stability, it undermines that feeling of future security that businesses and families need in order to plan and invest. And this puts a drag on economic growth. There is a monetary side to this uncertainty as well. The Fed announced that it's going to continue to hold interest rates at extremely low levels through 2014. I think this policy runs the great risk of fueling asset bubbles, destabilizing prices, and eventually eroding the value of the dollar. The prospect of all three is adding to uncertainty and holding our economy back in many of our judgments. And I fear that normalizing monetary policy when the time comes will be incredibly difficult. Not just technically difficult, but politically difficult as well. For instance, I was greatly concerned to hear that the Fed recently announced that it would be willing to accept higher than desired inflation in order to focus on the other side of its dual mandate, which is promoting employment. This is not because unemployment is a lesser concern, far from it. It is because the Fed's tools for promoting employment are limited, imprecise, and could have highly undesirable, unintended consequences. By contrast, the Fed is uniquely positioned to protect the currency, the value of our money. And I would find it very disturbing if that role were to be diminished. The inflation dynamic that can be quick to materialize and painful to eradicate once it takes hold. For the sake of our economy in particular, and the global recovery as a whole, it is vital that we focus on stability and certainty, especially when it comes to the value of the dollar. I firmly believe that a course correction here in Washington is sorely needed to help us get back on the right track. While it won't be easy, Americans have risen to greater challenges and have prevailed in the past, and we hope to provide a plan to do just that. With that, I'd like to yield to the ranking member, Mr. Van Hollen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Welcome, Dr. Bernanke. We must use all the tools at our disposal to help put people back to work, and I commend you and your colleagues at the Fed for using various forms of monetary policy to promote stable prices and higher levels of employment. I do find it troubling that at a time when millions of Americans are still out of work, many of our Republican colleagues want to strip the Federal Reserve of that part of its mandate that focuses on full employment and putting Americans back to work. Obviously, the Federal Reserve must not waver in its commitment to price stability, but to deprive you of the tools necessary to boost employment would be a big mistake. Indeed, without those tools, the economy today would be in much worse shape. Dr. Bernanke, as you testified previously before this committee, the measures taken by the Federal Reserve, the politically unpopular but economically necessary TARP legislation engineered by the Bush administration, and the Recovery Act by the Obama administration averted, and I quote what you said earlier, an extraordinarily severe downturn, perhaps a Great Depression. And indeed, we have averted a Great Depression. And it's important to remember that the day President Bush left office, the day President Obama was sworn in, the economy was collapsing at an even faster rate than originally thought. The gross domestic product was plummeting at a rate of 8.9%. In other words, negative 8.9% GDP, and we were losing 840,000 jobs every month. 3 years later, conditions have improved. The economy grew at an annual rate of 2.8% in the last quarter, and 3.2 million private sector jobs have been created since March 2010. Reports and findings by the Congressional Budget Office confirm your earlier assessments that the passage of the Recovery Act, coupled with the actions by the Federal Reserve and others, did help end the free fall and have helped begin the climb upward toward economic growth. Indeed, the Congressional Budget Office has told us that the Recovery Act helped save or create up to 3 million jobs in the year 2010 and lowered unemployment by up to 1.4 percentage points in 2011, compared to what it would have been if Congress had not acted. That's not my facts. Those are not my facts. Those are from the Congressional Budget Office. It's clear that we were on a huge, fast downhill slide, and action taken by the Federal Reserve, President Obama, and the Congress at the time helped end the economic freefall and begin to turn the corner. Still, we know that while the economy has improved, millions of Americans still remain out of work, unemployment remains unacceptably high, and American families around the country are still hurting. Our economy is still very vulnerable to outside shocks, whether it be the Japanese tsunami to the brewing European debt crisis. That is why our first priority has to be nurturing this fragile economy and making sure we do what we can to help small businesses and other businesses help put people back to work. So I commend you, Chairman Bernanke, in articulating in your prepared testimony that in pursuing medium and long-term fiscal sustainability, which we absolutely must do, we ought to take care not to slash investments too quickly, because those would impede the economic recovery. In fact, some policymakers in Europe are coming to this notion a little late. The British economy, for example, contracted by 0.2% last quarter, due in part to the severity of government spending cuts, according to the January 31st article in the Wall Street Journal. Of course, the British model was much heralded just a few years ago by some of our colleagues as an example of how austerity could work. Severe austerity is now coming back to bite them. Christine Lagarde, director of the IMF, was quoted by BBC just recently saying the IMF is not suggesting there should be fiscal consolidation across the board. Went on to point out that you need to look at this on a case-by-case basis. And ratings agency Standards & Poor, in a quote explaining the rationale behind their January 13th downgrade of 9 Eurozone nations, noted, and I quote, "A budgetary reform process based on a pillar of fiscal austerity alone risks becoming self-defeating as domestic demand falls in line with consumers' rising concerns about job security and disposable incomes, eroding national tax revenues," and by the way, of course, then also contributing to long-term deficits. These are reasons why we should take immediate action to take up the President's job plan, which he presented in September, including important investments in our national infrastructure. It's also why we should finish the job with respect to extending the payroll tax cut to 160 million working Americans and make sure that unemployment insurance is there for millions of others who are out of work through no fault of their own. And Dr. Bernanke, I apologize to you in advance. The conference committee on the payroll tax cut also begins at 10, so I'm going to have to leave before I want to. Let me just close by saying that as we nurture the very fragile economy, we should also take immediate steps to enact a plan to reduce our out-year deficits and debt. We should do it in a stable, predictable, and balanced way. The question is not whether we should do that. The question is how we do that. And I believe that the bipartisan commissions, Simpson-Bowles, Rivlin, Domenici, provide the overall framework to the approach for doing that, if not every specific recommendation they make. So with that, Dr. Bernanke, again, thank you and your colleagues for your work, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you. Chairman Bernanke, floor is yours.
Thank you. Chairman Ryan, Vice Chairman Garrett, Ranking Member Van Hollen, and other members of the committee, I appreciate this opportunity to discuss my views on the economic outlook, monetary policy, and the challenges facing federal fiscal policymakers. Over the past 2.5 years, the U.S. economy has been gradually recovering from a deep recession. While conditions have certainly improved over this period, the pace of the recovery has been frustratingly slow, particularly from the perspective of the millions of workers who remain unemployed or underemployed. Moreover, the sluggish expansion has left the economy vulnerable to shocks. Indeed, last year, supply chain disruptions stemming from the earthquake in Japan, a surge in the prices of oil and other commodities, and spillovers from the European debt crisis risk derailing the recovery. Fortunately, over the past few months, indicators of spending, production, and job market activity have shown some signs of improvement. And in economic projections just released, the Federal Open Market Committee participants indicated that they expected somewhat stronger growth this year than in 2011. The outlook remains uncertain, however, and close monitoring of economic developments will remain necessary. As is often the case, the ability and willingness of households to spend will be an important determinant of the pace at which the economy expands in coming quarters. Although real consumer spending rose moderately last quarter, households continue to face significant headwinds. Notably, real household income and wealth stagnated in 2011, and access to credit remained tight for many potential borrowers. Consumer sentiment has improved from the summer's depressed levels, but remains at levels that are still quite low by historical standards. Household spending will depend, in turn, heavily on developments in the labor market. Overall, the job situation does appear to have improved modestly over the past year. Private payroll employment increased by about 160,000 jobs per month in 2011. The unemployment rate fell by about 1 percentage point, and new claims for unemployment insurance declined somewhat. Nevertheless, as shown by indicators like the rate of unemployment and the ratio of employment to population, we still have a long way to go before the labor market can be said to be operating normally. Particularly troubling is the unusually high level of long-term unemployment. More than 40% of the unemployed have been jobless for more than 6 months, roughly double the fraction during the economic expansion of the previous decade. Uncertain job prospects, along with tight mortgage credit conditions, continue to hold back the demand for housing. Although low interest rates on conventional mortgages and the drop in home prices in recent years have greatly improved the affordability of housing, both residential sales and construction remain depressed. A persistent excess supply of vacant homes, largely stemming from foreclosures, is keeping downward pressure on prices and limiting the demand for new construction. In contrast to the household sector, the business sector has been a relative bright spot in the current recovery. Manufacturing production has increased 15% since its trough, and capital spending by businesses has expanded briskly over the past 2 years, driven in part by the need to replace aging equipment and software. Moreover, many U.S. firms, notably in manufacturing but also in services, have benefited from strong demand from foreign markets over the past few years. More recently, the pace of growth in business investment has slowed, likely reflecting concerns about both the domestic outlook and developments in Europe. However, there are signs that these concerns are abating somewhat. If business confidence continues to improve, U.S. firms should be well positioned to increase both capital spending and hiring. Larger businesses are still able to obtain credit at historically low interest rates, and corporate balance sheets are strong. And though many smaller businesses continue to face difficulties in obtaining credit, surveys indicate that credit conditions have begun to improve modestly for those firms as well. Globally, economic activity appears to be slowing, restrained in part by spillovers from fiscal and financial developments in Europe. The combination of high debt levels and weak growth prospects in a number of European countries has raised significant concerns about their fiscal situations, leading to substantial increases in sovereign borrowing costs, concerns about the health of European banks, and associated reductions in confidence and the availability of credit in the euro area. Resolving these problems will require concerted action on the part of European authorities. They are working hard to address their fiscal and financial challenges. Nonetheless, risks remain that developments in Europe or elsewhere may unfold favorably and could worsen economic prospects here at home. We are in frequent contact with European authorities, and we will continue to monitor the situation closely and take every available step to protect the U.S. financial system and the economy. Let me turn now to a discussion of inflation. As we had anticipated, overall consumer price inflation moderated considerably over the course of 2011. In the first half of the year, a surge in the prices of gasoline and food, along with some pass-through of these higher prices to other goods and services, had pushed consumer inflation higher. Around the same time, supply disruptions associated with the disaster in Japan put upward pressure on motor vehicle prices. As expected, however, the impetus from these influences faded in the second half of the year, leading inflation to decline from an annual rate of about 3.5% in the first half of 2011 to about 1.5% in the second half, close to its average pace in the preceding 2 years. In an environment of well-anchored inflation expectations, more stable commodity prices, and substantial slack in labor and product markets, we expect inflation to remain subdued. Against that backdrop, the FOMC decided last week to maintain its highly accommodative stance of monetary policy. In particular, the committee decided to continue its program to extend the average maturity of its securities holdings to maintain its existing policy of reinvesting principal payments on its portfolio of securities and to keep the target range for the federal funds rate at 0 to 1/4%. The committee now anticipates that economic conditions are likely to warrant exceptionally low levels of the federal funds rate at least through late 2014. As part of our ongoing effort to increase the transparency and predictability of monetary policy, following its January meeting, the FOMC released a statement intended to provide greater clarity about the committee's longer-term goals and policy strategy. The statement begins by emphasizing the Federal Reserve's firm commitment to pursue its congressional mandate to foster stable prices and maximum employment. To clarify how it seeks to achieve those objectives, the FOMC stated its collective view that inflation at the rate of 2%, as measured by the annual change in the price index for personal consumption expenditures, is most consistent over the longer run with the Federal Reserve's statutory mandate. And it indicated that the central tendency of FOMC participants' current estimates of the longer run normal rate of unemployment is between 5.2 and 6%. The statement noted these statutory objectives are generally complementary, but when they are not, the committee will take a balanced approach in its efforts to return both inflation and employment to their desired levels. In my remaining remarks, I'd like to briefly discuss the fiscal challenges facing your committee and the country. The federal budget deficit widened appreciably with the onset of the recent recession, and it has averaged around 9% of GDP over the past three fiscal years. This exceptional increase in the deficit has mostly reflected the automatic cyclical response of revenues and spending to a weak economy, as well as the fiscal actions taken to ease the recession and aid the recovery. As the economy continues to expand and stimulus policies are phased out, the budget deficit should narrow over the next few years. Unfortunately, even after economic conditions have returned to normal, the nation will still face a sizable structural budget gap if current budget policies continue. Using information from the recent budget outlook by the CBO, one can construct a projection for the federal deficit, assuming that most expiring tax provisions are extended and that the Medicare's physician payment rates are held at their current level. Under these assumptions, the budget deficit would be more than 4% of GDP in fiscal year 2017, assuming that the economy is then close to full employment. Of even greater concern is that longer-run projections based on plausible assumptions about the evolution of the economy and the budget under current policies show the structural budget gap increasing significantly further over time and the ratio of outstanding federal debt to GDP rising rapidly. This dynamic is clearly unsustainable. These structural imbalances did not emerge overnight. To a significant extent, they are the result of an aging population and especially fast-rising healthcare costs, both of which have been predicted for decades. Notably, the CBO projects that net federal outlays for healthcare entitlements, which were about 5% of GDP in fiscal 2011, could rise to more than 9% of GDP by 2035. Although we have been warned about such developments for many years, the time when projections become reality is coming closer. Having a large and increasing level of government debt relative to national income runs the risk of serious economic consequences. Over the longer term, the current trajectory of federal debt threatens to crowd out private capital formation and thus reduce productivity growth. To the extent that increasing debt is financed by borrowing from abroad, a growing share of our future income would be devoted to interest payments on foreign-held federal debt. High levels of debt also impair the ability of policymakers to respond effectively to future economic shocks and other adverse events. Even the prospect of unsustainable deficits has costs, including an increased possibility of a sudden fiscal crisis. As we've seen in a number of countries recently, interest rates can soar quickly if investors lose confidence in the ability of a government to manage its fiscal policy. Although historical experience and economic theory do not indicate the exact threshold at which the perceived risks associated with the U.S. public debt would increase markedly, we can be sure that without corrective action, our fiscal trajectory will move the nation ever closer to that point. To achieve economic and financial stability, U.S. fiscal policy must be placed on a sustainable path that ensures that debt relative to national income is at least stable or preferably declining over time. Attaining this goal should be a top priority. Even as fiscal policymakers address the urgent issue of fiscal sustainability, they should take care not to unnecessarily impede the current economic recovery. Fortunately, the two goals of achieving long-term fiscal sustainability and avoiding additional fiscal headwinds for the current recovery are fully compatible. Indeed, they are mutually reinforcing. On the one hand, a more robust recovery will lead to lower deficits and debt in coming years. On the other hand, a plan that clearly puts and credibly puts fiscal policy on a path to sustainability could help keep longer-term interest rates low and improve household and business confidence, thereby supporting improved economic performance today. Fiscal policymakers can also promote stronger economic performance in the medium term through the careful design of tax policies and spending programs. To the fullest extent possible, our nation's tax and spending policies should increase the incentives to work and save, encourage investments in the skills of our workforce, stimulate private capital formation, promote research and development, and provide necessary public infrastructure. Although we cannot expect our economy to grow its way out of our fiscal imbalances, a more productive economy will ease the trade-offs that we face and increase the likelihood that we leave a healthy economy to our children and grandchildren. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. We agree completely with the last part of your statement, which is if we don't get our fiscal house in order, it's going to get ugly pretty fast. Also, I want to salute you for having more transparency on the operation of the Federal Reserve. The latest FOMC statement clearly was an attempt to put your policy on the table and let the country see it. But it's in that policy that I have a couple of questions. Early on, you put out an inflation target rate of 2%. That puts more certainty, more clarity. But at the end of the statement, I'm just going to quote it. In setting monetary policy, the committee seeks to mitigate deviations of inflation from its longer-term goal and deviations of employment from the committee's assessment of its maximum level. These objections are generally complementary. However, under circumstances in which the committee judges that objectives are not complementary, it follows a balanced approach in promoting them, taking into account the magnitude of the deviations and the potentially different time horizons over which employment and inflation are projected to return to levels judged consistent with its mandates. Here's what I don't get. It seems as if you're moving away from an inflation target with that kind of a statement, and at best it's ambiguous. At worst, it says that if the deviation is higher on unemployment, which clearly it is, than it is on inflation, it follows my interpretation is that the Fed is willing to accept higher levels of inflation than your preferred rate in order to chase your employment mandate. Is that not what we should interpret out of this?
No, Mr. Chairman, I wouldn't say that's correct. So 2% is our definition of price stability. As part of our mandate, we want to achieve that 2% inflation rate in the medium term. Obviously, monetary policy works with a lag. We can't achieve it every day, every week, but over a period of time, we want to move inflation always back towards 2%. We are not seeking we will not actively seek to raise inflation or to move away from the target. We're always trying to bring inflation back to the target. The only sense in which there's a balance, of course, is that in looking at the two sides of the mandate, the rate of speed, the aggressiveness, may depend to some extent on the balance between the two objectives. But we're always trying to return both objectives back to their mandate. We are not seeking higher inflation. We do not want higher inflation, and we are not tolerating higher inflation.
The core mission of every central bank is stable prices. It's a necessary precondition for economic growth and therefore then full employment, at least in some of our judgment. And you and I have talked about mandates single versus double a lot. But if we're to say that we're now going to look at the deviations between the two, and if we're saying that our we think that full employment is 5.2 to 6%, we're clearly way above that, but at your PCE, we're closer to where your inflation target is, I don't know how other else to interpret this, that the result of this balanced approach is that higher than preferred inflation will maybe tolerated. Not that it's desired, but that it will be tolerated. And I'll simply just quote Paul Volcker, who said in the late 1970s, central bankers who are willing to tolerate a little more inflation usually end up getting a whole lot more than they expected. My concern is that this appears less to be an inflation targeting statement than an inflation equivocation statement, because we're now targeting deviations. And that's the concern. When this statement was released, we saw a buildup of commodity prices, even though I think you've said fairly recently that demand is down, therefore commodity prices should be low. So my basic question is, if this is our interpretation and we have a spike in commodity prices that occurred after the statement released, is that not the market's interpretation of this statement?
Mr. Chairman, first of all, as we say, the two sides of the mandate are generally complementary. I mean, we agree that low inflation, low stable inflation is good for the economy, and it's good for growth, it's good for employment, and we think most of the time that there's a complementary relationship between those two. The actual results, you mentioned, you discussed earlier the responsibility of the central bank for the dollar and for the price level. Inflation currently looks to be very well controlled. Our expectation, and of course we'll adjust policy as needed, but our expectation is that inflation will be below target over the next couple of years. Of course, unanticipated events can happen. The dollar's been pretty stable since the crisis. I don't think you should read into this any unwillingness to keep price stability as a critical goal of the central bank. All central banks, including those with a price stability mandate, take into account to some extent the overall state of the economy, but over the medium term, they seek to return inflation to the to its objective, and that's what we're intending to do.
So let me turn to quantitative easing. The Federal Reserve has applied an unusual and unprecedented amount of monetary easing for a long period of time, not just during the crisis moments, but well after that, and now apparently into through 2014. And by buying down Treasury rates, is it your view that this is putting an artificial cap on price discovery in the Treasury markets, and is that not lulling policymakers, fiscal policymakers, into a false sense of security when true price discovery in our Treasury markets, like it has in other countries, might give us the wake-up call we need to get our act in order to fix our problem? Are we not lulling ourselves in a false sense of security by this intervention in the Treasury markets?
Mr. Chairman, first, quantitative easing is very analogous to the usual monetary policy of cutting short-term interest rates. I mean, basically, that also lowers longer-term rates. It's basically a way of trying to provide more support for the economy. Our policies are hardly unusual. At this point, almost every major industrial central bank, excluding Canada, which had less of a recession than we did, has a large balance sheet and low interest rates, and including the ones with single mandates. And again, as I mentioned, you know, we're not having any signs of higher inflation or a declining dollar. In terms of the issue relating to distorting the bond market, again, it's the objective of the policy to get rates somewhat lower to provide more support for the economy and to bring inflation up to target if necessary. But I think the basic reasons for low long-term rates, which are also a feature of every other major industrial economy, are low inflation, slow expected growth, and the fact that the dollar is a safe haven. And with problems in the world, people are investing in U.S. Treasuries because they're attractive. I think it's important for me to say that if Congress is being lulled, they shouldn't be lulled. I think we agree that attention needs to be paid to these issues. As the case of some of the countries you're referring to, like Greece and Portugal, suggests, if investors lose confidence in the fiscal policy of a country, the rates are going to go up, and there's nothing the central bank can do about that. And so you should, obviously, it's important for Congress to address these problems, and I've spoken out about it quite consistently, as you know.
I think we would agree that we think sustainable long-run economic growth derives from savings and investment and therefore increased productivity instead of borrowing and consumption. I know you well enough to know that we more or less agree with that, but do you measure the effects that these policies have on savers, on people living on fixed income, living, you know, on CDs? Are you concerned at all about the very, very, very low interest payments that these savers are getting from these kinds of fixed income assets, which are hitting our savings and investment side of the economy in exchange for helping the borrowing and consumption side of the economy?
We are quite aware of that issue. We hear a lot about it. We consider it. We think about it. And, you know, I recognize that for people on a fixed income or whose main income is interest on a CD, I think I recognize that it imposes a hardship. The purpose of our policy, though, is to create a stronger economy. And savers collectively hold all the assets, all the capital in the economy. And if you don't have a strong economy, if you have a weak economy, you're not going to get good returns on all the other assets.
My time is running out. I just want to let me give you just a sense of this. A lot of us believe that the Federal Reserve was too loose for too long in the 2003 to 2005 period. And that is what, in part, led to the asset bubble and the malinvestment that occurred and the problems we have today. I know you don't agree with that, but because you don't agree with that, our fear is that you're just going to repeat these same mistakes again, but by orders of magnitude that we can't even comprehend right now. And that the Federal Reserve, whose primary goal is to manage our money, is involving itself in fiscal policy, is sort of bailing out fiscal policy because the branch of government in charge of fiscal policy, this branch, is not doing its job. I mean, a budget hasn't passed Congress in 2 years. We're going to pass a budget. We did one last year, but it's not passed. There's nothing in the Senate. So fiscal policy isn't being done the way it needs to be done. But that's not an excuse for the Federal Reserve to step in and try and bail us out, because that could be done at the expense of the priority, which is unique to the Federal Reserve, of maintaining our currency as a reliable store of value. And we fear that these exercises and these new ambiguous statements will compromise that. That's the point I'm trying to make. Mr. Van Hollen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Bernanke, thank you for your testimony. And you laid out what I think is a very clear two-track strategy for dealing with economic growth as we move forward. The first is recognizing the fiscal and budgetary challenge that we've got. And I think there's agreement on this committee that we need to come up with a predictable, stable way to reduce our deficits and debt. We've had disagreements over how we do it, but not whether we do it. And in looking at that, there are two lessons, I think, from what we see happen in Europe. One, of course, is the debt crisis, that if you wait too long to address these issues, you're right. Your borrowing costs are going to go up. People are going to lose faith. And we should heed that as an early warning and not delay putting in place those predictable changes. But your testimony also pointed out that there's a danger in overreacting to that in the near term in terms of the negative impact it could have on economic growth. And the other strategy that you've laid out is the need to nurture this very fragile economy we're in right now. So if you could just briefly talk about some of the lessons we've learned from the European experience, recognizing the debt crisis is an early warning system, but the austerity only and immediately approach, some countries can't avoid it, like Greece, because they've got themselves in a fix. But talk about the fact that austerity only and immediate deep cuts whether or not that can have a negative impact on the very fragile recovery that we're having now.
Well, the European situation is complicated. Among other things, of course, they have a monetary union and a fiscal disunion. They don't have the same kind of situation we have here. And you're correct also that there are some countries, like Greece, obviously, and others, that have very difficult fiscal sustainability issues, and they have tried to address those in the near term. You know, I hesitate a bit to advise my colleagues in Europe, but I would cite the IMF and others that point out that very slow growth or recession makes fiscal improvement more difficult because tax revenues fall and spending automatically rises if there are social safety nets and the like. So it's important to try to figure out what the right balance is there. And I want to be very clear. I don't want anyone to interpret me as saying anything other than that this Congress has a very difficult and important job to address the long-term fiscal sustainability of our federal budget. That's a critical thing. I think that even more aggressive strategies than have been pursued recently are warranted over the longer term. But I also think that that can be done in a way which is persuasive to markets and achieves those objectives, but doesn't quite jolt the recovery quite, and doesn't do it all, you know, all at once. I think that as long as there's a credible, strong plan over a period of time, and we move into that plan, that we'll achieve most of the objectives of fiscal sustainability. We need to at least avoid doing harm. I would say do no harm is an important piece of advice I would offer you. So there is a balancing act there that I think is important for us to pay attention to.
Thank you, Dr. Bernanke. And as you point out, those two goals are totally consistent. Sometimes they get muddled in the message, and I understand that sometimes people hear that, you know, interpret the need to prevent doing harm to the fragile economy now as meaning we shouldn't move ahead on long-term deficit reduction. Of course we should, as you said. You can do things at the same time, but if you undermine the fragile economy, as the IMF, as you indicated, has warned is being done with certain fiscal policies in Europe, that just creates an even bigger hole. And as I, again, apologize, have to leave to go to the conference on the payroll tax extension, if you could just comment on whether or not failure to extend the payroll tax cut for 160 million Americans and whether failure to extend unemployment compensation for millions of Americans who are out of work through no fault of their own, whether failure to do that would be a drag on what is already very fragile economic growth.
Congressman, I know you appreciate that I don't endorse individual tax and spending policies. I think that's a good approach for me to take. Obviously, you need to look at the whole picture. You know, I agree with what you said before that you can't do one and not the other. You know, you can't say, well, we got to protect the recovery and therefore we, you know, just completely put aside all of fiscal approaches to fiscal sustainability. You got to do both simultaneously, and you got to do both credibly. So I think it's the question of balance which is important.
Well, as just to follow, as I look at your GDP numbers, your growth projected growth numbers, it seems pretty clear that they assume some extension of current policy. For example, an extension of some of the at least through the end of the year payroll tax. I'm not saying specific numbers, but there are differences between those and CBO. And CBO had to assume current law. They had to assume we don't extend the payroll tax cut. And they have to assume that all the tax cuts at the end of the year, including middle income tax cuts, lapse. That's one of the reasons the CBO economic forecasts, GBG projections, are lower than yours.
Yeah.
So
mm-hmm.
I thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank my colleagues. And I'm going to
just yield the rest of the time to Mr. Dobbin.
Yield the time. And okay. I think he also has maybe a little time of his own as well. So thank you, Mr. Chairman.
So just so members, he's leaving, so we're going to allow Mr. Doggett to finish his time, then we'll go back and forth. Hold the clock for him. opposite.
Thank you very
much. Mr. Doggett. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your testimony. Just continuing along the same line of questioning Mr. Van Hollen was raising, Chairman Ryan has expressed some concern that under certain circumstances, the Fed pursues a balanced approach. Do you believe that the Fed is having any difficulty in achieving the goals of both employment and price stability?
Well, I think it's evident that particularly on the unemployment side, we've like to see greater progress than we've seen. On the inflation side, I'm very cognizant of Chairman Ryan's concerns, but at least for now, we appear to be pretty close to target. I think what I would say about that is, of course, we're going to have to continue to evaluate monetary policy as the new data come in and as we see how the outlook changes and so on. But I've said before, and I think it's important to emphasize, that monetary policy can't do everything. It's not a panacea. And this body and others need to think about the troubled parts of the economy, places where improvements can be made in the tax code or in other areas. And so, again, to answer your question, we're obviously not satisfied with where we are, and we look to, and while we will continue to do all we can to meet our dual mandate, which is what Congress has given us, we hope that that all of you and the administration and like will look for alternative ways to strengthen our economy.
And you certainly have the capacity to recommend to the Congress that it alter that mandate if you thought it was interfering with the objectives of the Fed.
I think it's been the dual mandate has worked fine. It hasn't. We have as good an inflation record as any other central bank. I don't think it's been a major problem. So I think it's served us well. That being said, Congress created the Fed. Congress gave us our mandate. If you determine that you want to change it, we will, of course, do whatever you assign us to do.
And you, of course, determine how to implement that mandate. And you've said, with reference to price stability, a goal of about 2% is your goal. And with reference to unemployment, did I hear you say 4.5% to 6%? 5.2% to 6%?
The difference, Congressman, the difference between inflation and unemployment is that the Fed can control inflation in the long run. We cannot control unemployment in the long run. That's determined by many other factors in labor markets and other policies that we do not control. So we can't set an arbitrary target, but what we can do is try to make our best guess of where the economy, what level of unemployment the economy could sustain over a period of time. We don't have an official number, but the 5.2 to 6% is the central tendency of the estimates provided by the members of the FOMC.
And while we would certainly be delighted to be at that range today or at the end of this year, that's still a substantial amount of unemployment, isn't it?
Certainly. We have a very high level of unemployment. We have not come remotely close to replacing the jobs that were lost in the recession. We have a very high level of long-term unemployment. I think we all agree that unemployment and underemployment and people leaving the labor force and all those things are a serious problem. I mean, we may disagree about remedies, but the problem is certainly there.
Right. And all I'm saying is that the objective that you've set in implementing the goal, I think I have another.
You'll have another five after Mr.
Oh, okay. Let me just finish then on this one point, that the objective you set is not an overly demanding objective as far as employment, the 5.2 to 6%.
We'll let you answer that in his next 5 minutes. Mr. Garrett, just to keep.
Sure.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. So I heard your answer to Mr. Van Hollen before with regard, and you said, well, you normally don't like to give a comment on with regard to fiscal policy, in particular tax bills and the like. And I thought, really, Mr. Chairman? Is that still your opinion?
Yes,
sir. I was truly taken aback when just recently, as you know, the Fed issued an unsolicited white paper, if you will, on housing policy, where if you didn't advocate for, you certainly mirrored much of the positions of this administration. So I don't know how the two go together. On the one hand, you say you don't get involved in these areas, But here you had a white paper that was not solicited from us. I know you're protective of your independence, but when you advocate for a position like that, why would you issue such a paper when we don't ask for it?
Well, Congressman, first, the Fed has a lot of interest in housing. It's important for the economy. It's important for monetary policy. We are bank supervisors, so we're interested in mortgage and lending and related issues.
So let me ask you this, then. Congress has a lot of interest in monetary policy. I guess the comparable would be for us to do a House resolution with regard to monetary policy. Is this an invitation now to Congress that we should be issuing resolutions to what the monetary policy that the Fed should be doing? If so, I'm sure there's a lot of members who would like to engage in it.
Well, I hear lots of advice from congressmen. could I say the bottom line here, yeah, though, is that we've done a lot of work on this. We've gotten a lot of requests from individual congressmen for our views and for our analysis. It was not the intent of that white paper to provide a set of recommendations. There was not a list of recommendations at the end of the white paper. We were trying to provide pros and cons, analysis, background. I'm sorry if you think we went too far, but we tried to provide useful information.
I hear that, but within 24 hours after that paper out, you know, the New York Fed president was out there basically advocating for some of the positions in there. Governor Elizabeth Duke was out there basically advocating for some positions out there. So you can't be on both sides of the issue where we're just saying this is what we think, and then the Fed president, the governor's coming out there saying advocating. And if it's because you're saying that members were asking your opinion, well, we were asking your opinion, and we would have certainly liked to have seen a white paper back when the president's colossal failure with the stimulus was going through, and we certainly would have liked a white paper at that time from the Fed to say just how that would have all worked out. Why didn't we see a white paper at that time spelling out whether this would work and whether you advocate or didn't advocate for the...
Well, I know you're skeptical, but we are trying very hard to avoid encroaching on Congress's fiscal responsibilities. With respect to the points you made about Governor Duke and President Dudley, they are not representing any official position of the board. They're speaking on their own recognizance. If you pay attention to the speeches that Reserve Bank presidents give, you know there's a wide variety of opinion, not even on monetary policy. So there was no official endorsement of those positions. We are, again, trying to provide useful background. I apologize if it was misinterpreted. Our goal was just to be helpful.
Well, I guess I would just sort of take off of what the chairman was talking about. You have two mandates in the area of employment, the area of the monetary policy, and that's obviously a lot for the Fed to be responsible for. We have a mandate in the area of fiscal policy, and we would like to retain that. Let me then go to another area. You do have a responsibility as the position they have. Well, you're the owner of about $1 trillion right now of mortgage-backed securities, right? In that position of the owner, wearing that hat, can you comment then on the president's new proposal on the refi plan? What have you looked into that? What would the impact be as far as realized losses to the balance sheet if that plan was to go through?
No, we haven't done that specific calculation. And once again, I'm not going to endorse or not endorse
not
a
endorsing,
specific
just
program.
What is the cost if we were to do that?
There are costs, as the president acknowledged. There are costs to it, and they would have to be raised somehow, whether it's from a bank tax or some other way. He mentioned $5 to $10 billion. We haven't looked at that number. We don't know if it's correct or not. There would also be costs to investors,
right,
including the Federal Reserve.
You're the investor in this,
yes,
situation. You bought these things, some would say, at a premium. So not that the cost to the taxpayer, but your cost. Have you begun to look to see what your cost would be as you the loss realized on those?
No, we haven't. Although we acknowledge, I think it should be acknowledged that that the rates of refinance have been extremely low, lower than expected over the last couple of years, and so in some sense that is reversing a gain that we got. But you're right. There are costs to the program. There are costs potentially to investors, and there's costs to the government potentially. So
that,
yes,
would be one area that we would like to have a specific information back on, and also as a regulator, what the impact would be for the banks that you regulate. What the impact would be if you increase the fees on them? And I see my time is out, but I look like
you,
for that information. Thank you, Mr.
Back
Chairman.
Back to Mr. Doggett.
Let me just return to the last question, and that is, many economists would think that unemployment of 5.2 to 6% leaves many people out there hurting badly in an economy, is a fairly substantial rate of unemployment, even though it's much, much better than where we are today. In setting your goals of trying to assure to avoid excessive price instability and inflation, you have not taken a drastic position on unemployment. You've tried to have some, as you said, balance between the two, have you not?
Well, there's nothing in our statement which suggests that we think that 5.2 to 6% unemployment is desirable or is a good outcome. We're just saying that given where the economy is today, that's what we think it can sustain under more normal conditions. There are many policies that Congress could consider, workforce skills and other things that might affect that long-run unemployment. And if that unemployment rate has changed, then we'll respond to that.
And on your estimates of what type of growth we will see in the near term in the economy that are in your testimony and the reports of the Fed, what assumptions do those estimates make concerning fiscal policy and where the Congress will be? I understand you're not getting into specific bills, pro and con.
Well, in order to make forecasts, we make guesses about what Congress will actually do. There's no endorsement or non-endorsement involved in that. Basically, the CBO presented sort of two kind of extreme proposals. One is the current law proposal, which assumes, for example, that all the tax cuts are ended and that the doc fix is not adopted and so on. And then there was a alternative scenario which sort of took the most...
Right. We had testimony about both yesterday.
Yeah, which assumed that there was no sequestration and that all the tax cuts were extended and you know, sort of took the opposite approach. Our numbers obviously are based on an intermediate level, assumes that some of these policies are undertaken, but not all of them, and we try to make our best guess, but it's only staff guesses about what they think Congress may do, and I don't think those forecasts are, the details of that are particularly helpful to you. I mean, you obviously you're going to be trying to figure out what the right thing to do is.
With regard to an issue we've discussed when you've been here in the committee before on whether the policies of the financial community concerning rewards and compensation for taking excessive risk remain a problem, you've finally issued a report in October dealing with that. Mm-hmm. It indicated that there had been some improvement, but among the largest banks, there continued to be a number of problems with regard to risk-taking and how that leads to rewards from some of those that are taking the risk with other people's money. Could you give us an assessment of what's happened since that report came out in terms of what progress is being made to deal with this issue that many of us are concerned could lead to another financial meltdown?
Well, the Federal Reserve undertook, even before financial reform was passed by the Congress, we undertook to look at this as a safety and soundness matter, and very early on we began working with the boards and the compensation committees of the major institutions to try to structure their compensation in ways that did not lead to more or excessive risk-taking. And I think, as the report suggested, we've made a good bit of progress. It's really sort of about that time of year when a lot of this information is finalized in terms of what the compensation packages are going to look like. We continue to make progress on that. We continue to work with the banks. I think that, as I said, I think that a lot of the major institutions have taken serious steps in this direction. I would point out, in addition, that beyond the actions that the Federal Reserve took independently, Dodd-Frank requires the Fed and other bank regulators to establish incentive compensation standards, and that rulemaking process is underway, and so that will augment and add to the guidance that we've already provided. So we have seen progress, and we continue to work actively with the banks to, I think in everyone's interest, make the banks safer and reduce the risks to the taxpayer.
Does more need to be done?
Well, we continue to work on it. I as we said in our report, we don't think that we're where we need to be necessarily. And I think that there's a lot of interesting questions. This is actually an active topic of academic research about how best to structure pay packages, what kinds of, what role should options and stock payments and so on play. So more does need to be done, but I think part of the process will be learning in our consultations with the institutions and with academics and others about, you know, what works best. And of course, Europeans are doing similar things in this interchange there as well.
Thank you. Mr. Simpson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Chairman, for being here today and for your testimony and comments. You know, I've been a member of this committee, and I think the chairman has also, for 8 years now. And for 8 years, we've had economists and other experts come and tell us that we have a structural deficit problem that is unsustainable, and we need to do something about it. So far, we failed to heed the warning. We are now at a situation where I think if we don't heed the warning, there's going to be consequences to play that nobody is willing to accept. And the sad thing about it is that both parties, Republicans and Democrats, sit and demonize one another no matter what we try to do to address this problem. We call the Democrats just tax and spend liberals that don't care about the economy, and they try to show us pictures of Paul Ryan pushing grandma off the cliff. Unfortunately, that doesn't solve the problem. When everyone in this room, everyone listening to us, and everyone on this committee knows what has to be done. We've had several commissions that have looked at what needs to be done. They all say, almost universally, that you've got to get to $4 to $6 trillion in savings if you're going to have an impact on the long-term deficit of this country, whether it's Simpson-Bowles, Domenici-Revlin, the Gang of Six, or whatever. We all know that we've got to restrain discretionary spending. We all know that we've got to get entitlements under control. And we all know that we need a pro-growth tax policy in this country instead of a 19th century tax code, one that fits the 21st century. We all know that. We might have some differences of exactly how to do some of these things, but we all know that the problem exists, and we all know we've got to come together. What we need is an armistice between Republicans and Democrats to solve this problem, because if we don't, all of these other things we talk about aren't really going to matter, are they?
That's correct. It is, I think, striking that when the U.S. Debt was downgraded by S&P last summer, it was more about what they cited was the political concerns about the ability of the Congress to work effectively to make progress. So it's easy for me to say, obviously, I recognize that politics is a tough game and that there are a lot of disagreements in Congress, but obviously the more that can be done to show cooperation and collaboration on this very important issue, I think we all agree on the issue, as you say, so I hope
I
very much.
I was surprised that this last 1st of January, I was in New Zealand and Australia and the Philippines, and talking with officials there and businesses there, I was surprised that they are really watching Congress. They're worried about Congress's inability to get together to solve this problem because they know that the problem is going to extend to them if we don't solve our problem here. And I was surprised that they follow us as closely as they do. But let me ask you, do you believe that the general assumption that we have to get to $4 to $6 trillion in savings is the right number or a number that will stabilize our deficit and get us headed in the right direction? And could you paint a picture, because it's sometimes hard for us to explain to the public what could potentially happen if we don't do anything. Could
sure.
you paint a picture for us of what you think will happen to this economy if we don't take the steps necessary to stabilize our debt, and if we put it off for another year or another year after that as we've been kicking that can down the road forever?
The $4 to $6 trillion, Congressman, was a number that was talked about for the next decade.
Right.
And the idea was that achieving that would stabilize the debt-GDP ratio and maybe get some progress there. And I was supportive of going big, so to speak, when we were discussing all these issues, we, the country, were discussing these issues last summer. So, I think a very substantial additional attack on the deficits is needed. But the other point I would make is that the $4 trillion, the $6 trillion number, is about the next decade.
Right.
The biggest problems we have are beyond the next decade. They stretch out into the next 20 or 30 years as entitlement costs in particular begin to rise further and as our demographics begin to move, some would say adversely. So one thing I would urge you as you think about these issues is not just to focus only on the 10-year official budget window, but to think about the longer term, even beyond 10 years, because what we've seen An example would be the Social Security reform that was done in the early 80s, which is still phasing in. It's not even all phased in yet, 30 years later. The more time you give people, the slower the process, the more warning, the more likely it's going to be successful, both politically and economically. So you need to look beyond 10 years. In terms of the implications for the economy, I think the good scenario is that, you know, we have, when the economy recovers, that we have higher interest rates, we have higher borrowing abroad, we have a slower growing economy, slower productivity gains, et cetera, as I discussed in my testimony. The bad case scenario, which ultimately will happen if we don't change this trajectory, is that, analogous to what we've seen in some countries in Europe, that investors will begin to lose confidence that we can manage our long-term fiscal situation, and we'll see sharp movements in interest rates or loss of confidence in U.S. U.S. debt, in which case changes would have to be made, but in a much more chaotic, rapid, and a disruptive way than by doing it in a long-term, thoughtful way.
Thank you. Mr. Blumenauer.
Thank you. Thank you again, sir, for joining us. I cringed a little with my good friend from New Jersey's portrayal. It seems to me that you are independent of Congress. You're not CBO. You are managing the monetary system, and you are purposefully an independent agency trying to insulate the notion that somehow you're at the beck and call of a particular administration or Congress. My understanding is that's the structure that is in place to try and give you that independence. Am I missing something here?
Well, the Fed was created by Congress, but Congress did set us up in a way, for example, 14-year terms for governors and so on, to try to create independence in making monetary policy decisions. We have a number of roles, including supervisory roles and so on, which bring us into contact with issues related to housing and mortgages and so on. But again, I just want to be clear to this committee that our intention was to try to provide useful background, and we, in all cases, looked at both sides of the issue, and we recognize, we have no doubt whatsoever, that it's Congress that has to make those decisions.
And I appreciate that. And I am of the, having been here through some of the stormy weather, I think there are lessons to be learned by all of us. I think you, some of your governors, looking at the events. I hope Congress is looking at what we did or didn't do. Hopefully people in the private sector. The notion that somehow we might ask the Fed to come up with a report on the Recovery Act. I mean, there is an independent agency. It's called the CBO, which we set up to give us that, who produced such a report that said that it raised real inflation-adjusted GDP between 0.3% and 1.9%, that it lowered the unemployment rate between 0.2% and 1.3%. It increased the number of employed between 400,000 and 2.4 million and increased the number of full-time equivalent jobs by between 500,000 and 3.3. That's an independent agency that Congress set up. You may not like the answer, but asking somebody else, an independent agency, to do it, I think, is not going to get us any further down the line. I am personally struck by what my good friend from Idaho said, because, as usual, he's making sense. Get to it, you know, deal with the notion. And I have opined in this committee and elsewhere that we know what to do. It's not that hard, that we could do things to rein in military spending without putting us at risk. We could reform agricultural spending. We could, in fact, move to have a healthcare system that rewards value instead of volume, that meets Mr. Bernanke's test, which isn't just in 10 years. The real test is 20 and 30 years that potentially sinks us. And I'm hopeful that we're able to focus on the big picture, that this budget committee, in the course of our deliberation, can look at things that actually enjoy bipartisan support that could make a difference over the next quarter century and not have the picture that is being portrayed today and yesterday by independent experts become a fulfilling prophecy. I just feel from the bottom of my heart that this is something we ought to be focusing on, and in particular, the notion that we are looking at the longer term. We live with a 10-year budget window, but the real challenges are beyond that, and that's where the savings have to occur. That's where it actually gets easier, not harder. And for us to bludgeon the Fed, and I think you've done an extraordinary job trying to balance being more transparent in what you're doing, but not spooking people, not adding fuel to one fire or the other. I appreciate your continued patience coming here, although I know it's probably a statutory duty, but you do it with good humor, and I don't know that we have subpoena power, but I'm hopeful that we can focus on the lessons that we learned or should have learned and get to the work that Mr. Simpson talked about in terms of getting to it.
Sounds like an endorsement of our budget.
I'll yield back. Thanks. I'm with you.
Okay, thank you. You are. Okay.
And I hope we...
Your gentleman's time has expired. Agreed. Mr. Campbell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Dr. Bernanke. A suggestion was made earlier that you make policy pronouncements on housing, and I'm very deeply, as you know, involved in how trying to restructure housing finance and the housing market. And as much as I personally wish that were true and that you would weigh in on the side of the proposals that I have made and versus others, you and the Fed have been, I think, quite judicious in not doing that. But what you have opined on, and I would like to ask you to say in your own words, is the importance of housing, the housing market, and a housing recovery if we wish to have a robust economic recovery and job growth. Would you care to comment on
that? Oh, I certainly would, and this is the reason that we have a housing committee, basically, at the Fed, which, you know, a bunch of staff and some governors who are looking at this almost all the time. I would say that one of the main reasons that the recovery has been as disappointing as it has been is that usually housing provides an important amount of the impetus to growth, not just construction, but all the related industries and services that are tied to housing. In this case, housing has been very weak. And in fact, it really is, we've seen a few small positive indicators, but generally remains at a very low level. So the housing, the recovery in housing would be a very important boost to the overall recovery. It works through a number of different ways, not just through construction, but by affecting the wealth of consumers and their financial well-being. The mortgage market, the problems with access to credit, for example, mean that the Federal Reserve's monetary policies are less effective than they otherwise would be, because not as many people as could be are taking advantage of the low mortgage rates that we have tried to create. There's a lot of other implications for both borrowers and lenders. Clearly, continued poor conditions in housing markets imply losses on mortgages, imply foreclosures, imply people underwater who can't move or sell their houses. So there are a lot of costs at the neighborhood and the household level as well. But I do think that the lack of a housing recovery is one of the big reasons that recovery's not been more stronger than it has.
So without advocating a specific solution, kind of like on the budget deficits, you're saying it's something to which we should be paying policy attention.
I think it would repay your efforts to think about ways to make to remove some of the barriers to the recovery in housing. I don't think it's purely a market phenomenon. I think there are a number of legal and administrative and regulatory barriers to housing being as strong as it should be.
Thank you. Shifting gears for a second and going to Europe, could you comment on, in the last 30 days or 60 days, has a recovery or a positive solution in Europe? Is it closer or farther away in your view? And can you, and we can't control this, but yet if they were to have a failure of some sort over there, which was not well constructed or whatever, that would affect us. Could you comment on where you think Europe is today and what impact it would have on us, even though we can't control it, if they were to have some form of failure or collapse?
Certainly, Congressman. So there have been a couple of positive developments. The European Central Bank has provided extensive financing to the European banking system and will provide another round of financing at the end of this month. That has had the benefit of reducing some of the stresses in the banking system. It has even gone so far as to bring down, to some extent, the borrowing costs of some of the more fiscally troubled countries as well. So that's taken away some of the financial stress and has given a little bit more breathing space. There's also been progress made in terms of a international agreement within the Eurozone to have mutual surveillance of fiscal policies to try and get long-term agreement on fiscal stability within the Eurozone and within individual countries, and that's a necessary condition for a full solution. So those are positive things. But there's an awful lot remains to be done. The Greek negotiations are still ongoing. We don't know how those are going to come out. The banking system remains undercapitalized. It's been contracting its credit, which has been contributing to a weakening in economy in many countries in Europe. And I think, you know, the backstops that are needed to protect, if one country has problems, to protect other countries from contagion, the Europeans have been setting up financial backstops to do that. There's still a lot of uncertainty about the size of those backstops and how they'd be used and so on. More work needs to be done there. But I think it's important to finally just to conclude that there are some really deep fundamental problems, not just fiscal issues, slow growth issues, but also issues of competitiveness. Countries on the periphery like Greece and Portugal are not at all competitive to Germany. They have big current account deficits. They cannot change the value of their exchange rate because they're tied to the euro. So it's going to be a very difficult process for them to get to a more competitive situation, and that all those things put together mean that you could have very slow growth in some European countries for quite a while.
Ms. Castor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning.
Good morning.
Dr. Bernanke, the economy is creating jobs. We've had 22 months of private sector job growth. The unemployment rate is at its lowest level for 3 years, and it's very noticeable at home in Florida. You know, in 2007 and 2008, the headlines in the newspapers were devastating about companies closing and people losing jobs, and it's noticeably different. It was noticeably different last year with stories about companies hiring. It's pretty steady right now, but obviously we can do better. And I mean, you've said in your testimony, you said a more robust recovery will lead to lower deficits and debts in coming years. So here's the frustration, and our colleague who gave us the list of ways to reduce the debt and deficit, it was very noticeable that he did not include job creation in that list. It was cut spending. We're doing that in the Budget Control Act. We did that. We need to do more entitlements. There's some common ground we could find there. But he left off that very important list, job creation. And Dr. Elmendorf from the CBO testified yesterday that yes, if we had a lower unemployment rate, we would have a lower deficit. And that followed up on his letter of October, where he used technical language, says the underutilization of capital and labor resources in the economy. If we had better utilization, if we had more people working, the projected federal deficit under the current law in fiscal year 2012 would be about one-third lower. That deficit would be equal to about 4.0% of gross domestic product, compared with 6.2% projected for 2012 in the CBO's baseline. If the economy were operating at its potential, the deficit would be lower because incomes and therefore revenues would be higher, while the rate of unemployment and therefore outlays for certain government programs would be lower. So here's our frustration, and the frustration of folks back home. They know we can be doing more to reduce the deficit and put people back to work, but the Congress has not been able to get off the dime and come to common agreement on ways we invest in infrastructure and research and development. So give us some words of wisdom on this. Going forward, what do you believe are the most effective policy options that all of us can pursue to speed job creation and thereby lower the deficit?
Well, Congresswoman, first of all, I'm glad to hear that the tone is a little better in Florida. That's good. There has been some progress, obviously, but it's still very slow. In my testimony, I think three related points about fiscal policy. The first is that whatever we do, for confidence purposes and for long-run sustainability, we got to keep our eye on the long term. We got to make sure that we have a credible plan put in place that will be moving us towards stability and sustainability in our fiscal policies over the next few years and into the subsequent decades. So I think we got to keep that part always on the table. I think that's really important. Secondly, I think we can avoid unnecessary disruption to the recovery. I think that's important. Mr. Elmendorf, I'm sure, pointed out that under current law, there's going to be a massive fiscal contraction in 2013. Without addressing any of the specific policies involved, I think Congress should be aware of that and try to avoid having too big a hit on the recovery in 2013. And then finally, I think my third point was that fiscal policy is not just about total spending and total taxes. A lot of it is the quality of the budget. I mean, are the things we're spending on, are they going to help our economy? Do they support R&D or workforce skills or other things that will help the economy grow in the long run? On the tax side, are we moving towards more efficient, more effective tax codes, simpler, fairer, and the like? So I think you want to look at the top lines, total spending and total taxes, the deficit, but obviously, and it's easy for me to say, but it makes a difference. The quality of the programs, the way the money is spent, the way the money is collected, makes a difference in terms of jobs and growth.
Mr. Cole.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And before I get to my questions, I want to thank you for the role you played during the TARP situation, which I think was a critical point for the country. And I want to thank you for the transparency and the efforts since then, I think, to try and restore a measure of public confidence in the Fed. In the history of the periods written, I think a lot of people, Fed, SEC, the GSEs, Congress, are going to have a lot to answer for in the lead up. But at the moment of crisis, I think you did a really terrific job for the country, and I appreciate it very, very much.
Thank you.
You laid out pretty compellingly the fiscal challenge that we face going forward, and I think that's what we wrestle with on this committee more than almost anything else. And let me posit a couple things and then try and get your opinion on it if it's appropriate. First, you mentioned spending restraint, and that's actually beginning to happen. Appropriations Committee has actually cut discretionary spending two budget years in a single calendar year. We have an agreement in the Budget Control Act going forward that's going to let out the belt a little, but honestly, in the context of the federal budget, not a lot. We can argue about whether it was good policy or not, but we did tie long-term spending cuts in some fashion to the debt ceiling increase. So there's lots of signs that, at least on the discretionary side, we're beginning to see some discipline, and it's likely to stay here for a while. Second, on the revenue front, the president obviously extended all the tax cuts for 2 years. He had the ability not to do that. He could have knocked all of them out or any of them that he wanted to knock out because we couldn't have possibly overridden the veto, and frankly, he had majorities until January to do pretty much what he wanted. He told us pretty clearly then that he thought we needed those tax cuts for another 2 years, and he bargained in exchange for that an extension of unemployment, and obviously the payroll tax holiday, and but he signaled that, you know, look, come January next time, we're going to have a revenue increase for high-income earners if I'm still the President of the United States. And he'll have the ability to impose that if he chooses. So let's just posit for a minute, hate to do this as a Republican, that he's in the position to do that. So that'll be a revenue increase of some sort. Are those two things in and of themselves, spending restraint and revenue increases of the kind that we're talking about, sufficient to deal with the long-term structural deficit that you describe?
No, I don't think they are, and I think standard CBO calculations would support that. Discretionary spending is not particularly high as a share of GDP relative to history. I think you could cut discretionary spending pretty close to zero and not solve the problem in the long term. So focusing only on discretionary spending is probably not going to be by itself sufficient on the spending side.
And I don't mean to put words in your mouth, or only on the revenue side. I mean only on the tax side.
Well, I was going to say on the other side that there are many arguments for and against changing the taxes on higher income individuals, but that by itself is not going to close the budget deficit either. We need a much broader set of policies. I think the elephant in the room is really healthcare costs. As I mentioned in my testimony, you know, we're heading towards 9 or 10% of GDP just from federal spending on healthcare, and then another 8 or 9% eventually in private sector healthcare spending. So that's a broad issue that affects the budget and affects the efficiency of our economy that I don't think we're going to get a real solution there without some kind of way of addressing that problem.
I agree very much with that, and obviously we had an effort in this committee to do exactly that in the so-called Ryan budget. I suspect we'll have something very similar again this year. I hope we look at Social Security as well. I know that decision hasn't been made because I think that's the crux of the issue. But you know, we have a lot of commissions that put out a lot of ideas. Are you aware of any other elected officials that have actually passed or proposed? Has the president laid out a set of long-term reforms in entitlement spending, or anybody else other than my friend, the chairman here?
I don't know of any comprehensive plan. Again, as you point out, there have been a number of commissions which have, even those commissions are not fully, you know, detailed. I mean, for example, I don't think Bowles Simpson had a lot to say about health care and how to control that spending. But that's where, I mean, I think that's where, you know, a lot of the serious work has been done is in think tanks and the like.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Pascarell.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for bringing us together today. Chairman, I want to associate myself with the comments of Mr. Cole as to keeping a steady head through this real, real financial crisis, economic crisis. And I can appreciate that it's not a very easy task, nor is it an easy task for this committee. First chart up there, Mr. Chairman, we've heard a lot about how some people can pay 15% a tax rate around 10% to 30% lower than firefighters, teachers, and police officers, as an example, particularly in North Jersey. I understand you can use a 15% rate on investment income rather than the higher 35% top rate on wage income. We've been told that increasing the rate on capital gains will discourage investment. Warren Buffett said that he had worked with investors for 60 years, and he's yet to see anyone, not even when capital gains rates were 39.9% back in the mid-70s. He's never seen someone shy away from a sensible investment because of the tax rate on the potential gain. People invest to make money, and potential taxes have never scared them off, unquote. Now, according to the National Income and product accounts tables, the top tax rate on investment income significantly changed over the past 80 years, which you're very familiar with, which I've heard you speak about many times. It was as high as 39.7% in 1976, and now it's today 15%. Yet investment grows with the cycle. Chairman, in your opinion, do changes in the capital gains tax rate mainly affect investments already made rather than new investments being considered? And the latter is what drives growth. What's your opinion?
Well, you're pulling me into a complex topic. So the economic theory says that that you should tax consumption rather than saving or investment, and that's the rationale for lower rates on capital gains and capital income. That's a theoretical result. There's a variety of estimates about how strong the effect is, which is what you're alluding to. It's hard to pin it down exactly. There are many other issues related to this, which make it, I don't want to be pinned down on a simple response, because on the one hand, the low investment income, tax on investment income, as I said, can be justified by economic theory, it can be justified by arguments to the need for personal corporate tax integration and so on, but I think Congress has an appropriate task to try to balance whatever benefits that low taxes on capital income have against considerations of equity, considerations of implementation. Can people convert regular income into interest income or capital gains income and thereby evade taxes? So there's some complex issues on both sides. To try to answer your question, I think there's certainly, while there's some disagreement in the literature, I think there is some effect of the rate of return on after-tax rate of return on investment decisions, but there is a lot of disagreement about how strong it is.
Do you see the problems as it is, not just that the rate on capital gains is so much lower than the rate on earnings, and we could discuss that at length because we've seen a real turnaround in the last 50 to 70 years on what we do tax. And one that feeds those who say that income earners are at a disadvantage in terms of what we've made, well, how we've taxed the profits of investments. The problem amplified by the, we debated this, the carried interest loophole that encourages tapping the difference. What's your opinion about that?
Time for the gentleman's expired. I appreciate
it. Can he answer the question?
I'm going to punt anyway. I think it's a complicated question.
Get to everybody else here, Dr. Price.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do want to comment about Warren Buffett. Warren Buffett peculiarly has become kind of a financial guru, making recommendations for some peculiar reason. I'm not quite certain. He's a gentleman who, as I understand it, won't release his tax returns, who pays himself an income of $100,000, who's never contributed any more to the federal government. In fact, he's doing all he can not to pay taxes to skirt his responsibilities. So, but that's a complete aside, and I apologize for it. Ms. Chairman, I thank you for coming, and I want to talk, I want to turn our attention to the European situation. The European situation, to quote your testimony, is, quote, leading to substantial increases in sovereign borrowing costs, concerns about the health of European banks, and associated reductions in confidence and the availability of credit in the euro area. Resolving these problems will require concerted action on the part of European authorities. My first question is, do you believe that loans to European countries today carry a greater risk than they did 2 or 3 years ago?
When you say to countries, do you mean to the governments?
Yes.
Surely they do, and you can see it in the interest rates that they have to pay.
And would you please explain what the exposure of the United States, the American taxpayer is to that credit challenge that they have?
Well, in the official sector, the United States is a 15% shareholder of the IMF. The IMF is involved in programs for the three small countries that Greece, Portugal, and Ireland. The IMF does have a very good record of being paid back. They have a senior position in the debt of those countries, and they are very much engaged in making sure that those countries are taking appropriate policies. As I've explained in previous venues, the Federal Reserve has a swap line with the European Central Bank. That is not an obligation of any European government directly. The European Central Bank is highly creditworthy. It is owned by the central banks of all the countries in the Eurozone. And moreover, they give us euros as collateral, so it's a swap of currency rather than a loan per se. They lend the proceeds onto their banking system in dollars, and there's some important reasons for that. But from an exposure point of view, they take all the credit risk, all the interest rate risk, and all the exchange rate risk, and I think it's a good bargain for us.
Are you able to quantify the exposure of the U.S. taxpayer to the risk through the IMF and elsewhere?
Through the IMF? I don't have the number exactly, but it would be in the tens of billions.
It may even be higher than that, I think. Do you believe that it's appropriate for the United States, for the Fed, and hence the United States taxpayer, to have a greater exposure through the IMF, or are we at about where we ought to be? Or should we decrease our exposure?
Well, I think the IMF plays a really important role in helping to stabilize countries that are in stress. The administration, the Treasury Secretary is our director, and he has the most direct responsibility for the IMF, and he's been very clear that he's not supportive of any increase in the U.S. contribution to the IMF. And so I would leave that to his judgment. His view is, as I understand it, you should speak to him, of course, his view is that it's up to the Europeans first to take the necessary actions to stabilize the situation.
Let me switch very quickly in the brief moments that I have left to the comments that you made about health care and Medicare, Medicaid. Our discretionary budget is about $1 trillion. The amount of the deficit is greater than $1 trillion. So one could do away with all discretionary spending, isn't it correct? You could do away with all discretionary spending and not even get to a balanced budget without addressing Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security, and
Well, part of the $1 trillion deficit is due to the fact that the economy is in very weak condition, and the CBO suggested that if the economy returns to normal, say by 2017, that the deficit would be more in the order of 4 to 5%, which would be in the order of, in today's terms, $60 to $75 billion. So that's not the balance. It's not quite what you said, but what I said before is true, that discretionary spending cannot bear the entire brunt of deficit closing. It's just not arithmetically possible.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Tonko.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Dr. Bernanke, Chairman Bernanke, thank you for appearing before the committee. I represent a part of upstate New York that hosts the third fastest growing high-tech jobs hub in the country. And we have a higher share of our workforce in green-collar jobs than anywhere else in America. And the innovation economy in our region isn't just a talking point, it's a reality that's paying bills for many, many families. Came about with a huge bit of planning and the investment from both public and private sectors in providing the industrial clustering that's currently underway. So I'm interested in your comments about the investments that need to be part of the response to a troubled economy that encourage investments in R&D, in the development of skills of a labor force that's essential for an ideas economy, and also the requirement of sound public infrastructure. After 20 years of investment through work in the policy development in the State Assembly, and when I was at NYSERDA, the State Energy Research and Development Authority, we saw what happened when people brought it all together and now enabled us to experience this comeback. Interestingly, when I arrived here, I saw a lot of tug against investment in these given dynamics that you made mention of. Can you develop further for us the benefit, the value added that comes with this focus on R&D, on skill set, and on infrastructure?
Yes, there's a lot of evidence that clustering can be beneficial, as you described. If you have a number of high-tech industries, for example, close together, they can share ideas and suppliers, workforce, and the like. The public sector has a role there. One of the great strengths of the United States is our university system. Many of the high-tech clusters, I don't know about the one you're speaking of, have grown up in the context of a strong university where there's a lot of exchange between scientists or other professionals in the university and in the private sector. And of course, the U.S. government is, you know, has many supports university education in many direct and indirect ways. Of course, it also supports public education for younger people, and the high-tech industries require skilled workers, a range of people, but certainly people who are conversant with math and science is very important. So there's some important roles. Infrastructure, you know, I think while that's certainly a topic of debate about how much and how what kind, I think most people agree that there's certain kinds of infrastructure that the government has a role in providing, from roads to airports to public crime and firefighting services and a variety of things. And so, you know, to the extent that can support activity, that's useful. Research and development is an interesting question. I recently gave a speech on this topic and talked about some of the considerations about what role, if any, the government should play there. And I think, you know, that again, it's an issue debated among economists, but there's some argument to the fact that basic, in a purely, without any government intervention, that purely basic research may be underprovided because the people who are doing that don't share in all the benefits from that. So there may be some case for government encouragement of basic research. And of course, you have a R&D tax credit. That's certainly one way that, you know, there are other ways as well, support National Science Foundation and so on, to support research and development. So I think the lesson of experience is that industrial policies which attempt to dictate exactly what companies, exactly what products are not generally very successful. There often is a role for government partnerships, you know, to help create the basis where private sector can be very productive, particularly in high-tech areas.
Do you have any sense of how we might fare with the international community in terms of R&D investment?
We do pretty well, including both public and private. We are certainly the biggest absolute amount of, we have this biggest amount of, in absolute terms, of research and development investment. And we have a pretty high percentage of GDP as well. Some emerging markets like China are beginning to approach us, at least in terms of share of GDP, but we remain an R&D leader.
Thank you.
Mr. Flores.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Chairman Bernanke, for joining us today. I want to follow up on some of the questions we've had earlier today and to talk about policy responses. As you said, you're worried about the federal government's fiscal sustainability as we move forward. And it looks to me like we don't really have to reinvent the wheel when it comes to policy responses. If you look at this chart that we have on the screen, you can see the differences in recoveries
during the 2007-2011 time frame versus 1982 to 1986. There was an article, or actually an op-ed in the Wall Street Journal this morning by Phil Graham and Mike Salon that said that if we had just followed the same policies that Reagan followed when he inherited a really bad economy, that we would have about 17 million more Americans working today, and that our GDP per family would be about $23,000 higher. So that the basic question, I mean, we all recognize that the Constitution says the federal government has certain basic responsibilities. It's explicit that we have to provide for national security. Some people feel like we need to provide for basic research funding, and I agree with that particular idea. But then everything else is really sort of on the table when it comes when you look forward. So my questions are fairly simple. I'd like you to give me the abbreviated, abridged, Reader's Digest Fed response, if you can. Who's the better allocator of capital to the greater public good? Is it the private sector or the federal government?
Well, as I was saying earlier, there are some areas where the federal government is really the only provider. It's very hard to get the private sector to provide
just macro, let's
roads,
say really 50,000.
But for innovative industries and those sorts of things, I think it generally agreed that the private sector is better. And you know, China is an example of a country which has a communist party running the show, but they allow private sector activity a very large role in the development of new industries.
Right. How about, I mean, you've got difference between private sector investments like Keystone Pipeline versus public sector investments like Solyndra. I mean, that one's pretty obvious at face value that the federal government does a pretty poor job of allocating resources. Do you see anything that should dissuade us from thinking that it'd be better for the private sector to allocate resources instead of the federal government?
Well, again, the private sector, because of the profit motive and so on, is often better in innovating. There are, but again, I don't want to get into the Keystone situation. Don't know enough about it, but I do know it involves a multi-state, right of way and all those environmental issues.
I wasn't trying to get the weeds on Keystone. Yeah. I'm just saying as an example. Mm-hmm. You've got on one hand you've got a private investment of $7 billion and thousands of jobs created. On the other hand, you've got a half a billion taxpayer dollars that have been spent and no jobs today.
You can, to be fair, you can point to situations where government investments in the space program or in the internet have paid off. Have paid off for the public. But clearly, we have a market economy, and we want to use the market wherever appropriate.
Good, exactly. Looking at the stimulus plan, if you use the most aggressive, optimistic numbers of jobs created or saved that have been promulgated, the cost of the stimulus plan divided by the number of jobs is about $400,000 per job. Would you say that the private sector could have done better than that if we had just said, okay, private sector, through some sort of tax reform or tax reduction, we're going to leave those stimulus dollars in the hands of the taxpayers to start with instead of cycling them through Washington? Would that have created a better economic outcome for the United States?
Well, it's hard to say. I mean, we were in a deep recession, one of the differences between this recession and the 82-86 was that the Fed's tightening to reduce inflation was one of the main reasons for the 82 recession. And so when the Fed relented and cut interest rates, that was a big reason for the recovery. In this case, rates are zero. We can't do as much as they did in the mid-80s. Your question. So the other thing I guess I would comment dividing the total cost by the number of jobs is not exactly the right way to think about it because the total cost involved also the provision of whatever was built or constructed.
I wasn't trying to get into the Nats like that. I'm just saying, in a macro level, what would have been a better policy response? What would have produced a better economic benefit for the average American? $800 billion in the hands of the taxpayers? Or
if I could just quickly respond, I think there are times when monetary and fiscal policy can help to create better employment, but the private sector clearly is where the decisions about what industries, what products, and so on should take place.
Very good. Thank you.
Ms. McCollum.
Thank you,
you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chair, back to the chart that we just had. Could that could I ask to have that put up again, even though it was not my chart? Chairman Bernanke, some of my colleagues are talking about the Reagan recovery a lot more. But I think when you talk about recoveries, you have to also have to talk about how you got in the position you're in. You talked about how the Fed had interest rates to work with during the so-called the recovery, not so-called. We did recover during the recession that was pointed out with Mr. Durgan. But I think it's important historically to point out that with what we're facing right now, we had two wars that went on credit cards. We had a housing collapse, which really embroiled us into, as you pointed out, housing being the last leg maybe of this recovery moving forward. So you really can't compare the two and say that the same solutions would have worked for this recovery. And then the other question I might ask you is, would you say that 2007 is a fair starting point for talking about where the recovery started on this chart?
No, December 2007 is the beginning of the recession. The recovery began, according to the NBER, in June of 2009. But you know, I think this has been a unique experience, this last crisis. We've never had a housing boom and bust and such an impact on the financial system as this particular example. The financial crisis was extraordinarily severe. We did come very close to a total global meltdown. And while people can disagree about how much that's held back the recovery, I'm sure that tight credit and mortgages and small businesses and some other areas has been part of that. And I think the monetary policy issue is an important one. I mean, mortgage rates in the early 80s were 18% or something like that. And letting interest rates come down as the Fed lightened up, as inflation came down, was certainly part of why the economy bounced back as quickly as it did. And housing was one of the areas that bounced back. So I you know, obviously there's some comparability of all recessions, but there's some important differences as well.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, in my remaining time, I'd like to kind of go back to some of the discussion that we've had about our interaction with the economies on an international market. And we're facing some decisions, and I believe that we need a balanced package of revenue, spending cuts, as a robust discussion about how we move forward. But there's many in Congress, some of my colleagues, who want to, you know, implement deep cuts. Going back to some of the discussions that you were having with Mr. Tonko, I had an interesting meeting with Ford Motor Company a couple years ago, and they said, you know, if we had an energy plan that would allow Ford to determine to go gangbusters, whether it's going to be electric, whether it's going to be biofuels, whatever, if we have an energy policy that countries like Japan have an energy policy, the EU came out deciding to go diesel, that would really help our business sector be part of global competition in the way forward with competitiveness. Can you maybe talk about energy policy and a determinants for our country to really embrace one to allow our businesses to kind of move forward together? Ford really said, when they knew that they had to build diesel, they could build the best diesel car. They were totally competitive in Europe. But the lack of us having an energy policy for a nation as large as ours really left them up in the air.
Well, I think companies would like to have clarity about what energy sources are going to be used, how the government is going to tax or subsidize different types of energy. I think the main issues there, frankly, are environmental as much as anything else. You know, Japan, for example, has decided to phase out its nuclear power because of the safety concerns. The EU decision on diesel, I think, was generated primarily by environmental issues. So those are the kinds of issues that's an area where government, you know, may make some decisions about energy policy because certain types of energy, it may be judged are better for the environment. Putting that aside, we do need to maintain a role for energy markets, as we were talking about this before. There's a remarkable increase in the supply of natural gas, for example, in the United States, and that's a good thing, as long as we can manage it in a safe and environmental sound way.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Mr. Mulvaney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Bernanke, I want to drill down a little bit on something you've talked about in general here today, which is Europe, and I want to go into some detail on the central bank liquidity swaps, what some folks call the dollar swap agreements. Since you've been here last time, I think it's grown from the agreements with various central banks have grown from roughly $2.8 billion to about $103 billion as of last week. Mm-hmm. And my first question is, where does that money come from? Is that money that you have existing reserves? Is that new money? Where does that $103 billion come from that we participate in those agreements?
It becomes both a liability and an asset on the Federal Reserve's balance sheet. I mean, it's some sense paid for by greater excess reserves in the banking system. And on the other side, we have an asset, which is the money given to the, in exchange to the European Central Bank.
But to the extent it's greater excess reserves, that would be, in layman's terms, new money. It's not money that you took out of a maturing treasury and then moved over to a swap agreement. This is money that you set aside for this.
We chose to do it that way because monetary policy currently obviously has rates very close to zero. But it would not be difficult to sterilize that through a number of different methods.
Fair enough. You stated earlier that it's your current intention with all of your maturing securities to reinvest those. As these securities mature, I think 90% of them are less than 90 days, or actually all of them are less than 90 days, is your intention to reinvest those in domestic securities, reinvest them in the swap agreements? What's your current intention?
Well, the demand, it's the ECB and the Bank of Japan, the two main counterparties who would determine, you know, what their request is, and then we would decide whether or not to grant the request. So it's not our choice. You know, we're not looking to invest there. If the swaps run out, then that will just be extinguished. It'll mean a comparable drop in our liabilities and in our assets.
Fair enough. But to the extent part of this $103 billion goes over to Europe in the swap agreements, comes back within the term of the agreements, and are reinvested in domestic securities, does that have an expansionary effect on the domestic monetary supply?
It does increase the high-powered money supply a little bit. In this case, it would be about 4%, 3-4%. It does not, in practice, have much effect on money in circulation. Only the amount of excess reserves that the banks are holding with the Fed. So we don't, and it doesn't affect interest rates. So what we see it as doing is reducing financial stress, strengthening the role of the dollar in international markets, improving funding for both U.S. and foreign banks. We don't see it as having any major implications for inflation, for example.
How is that different, what you've just described, from what you were trying to accomplish with QE1 and QE2?
Well, the difference being that with QE1 and QE2, we were first of all, they were much bigger. Secondly, we were buying medium to long-term securities on the open market. In this case, the money is going via the ECB, who are our counterparty and take all the risks, are going to help finance the dollar assets of European banks, which is then put back basically in the ECB's.
So I understand the first half of the transaction, but when the money comes back from Europe and you reinvest it, how is that different from QE1 and QE2?
There's no change. This doesn't involve any change in our holdings of securities. We have an asset, which is the obligation of the ECB, and we have a liability, which is increase in excess reserves. Unless banks are lending those reserves out, it's not going to be turning into more money supply.
You've got the option, as you exercised in 2008, to lend this money directly to the European banks. You could do it to domestic subsidiaries of European banks. Why aren't you doing that? Why are you using the swap agreements instead of lending directly to domestic subsidiaries of overseas banks?
Well, if there was domestic subsidiaries of overseas banks came to the discount window, by law, we have to treat them on an even playing field with U.S.-only banks. We do not have any lending right now through the discount window. From our perspective and an economic perspective and from the U.S. taxpayer's perspective, doing it through a swap is much better because it's the responsibility of the ECB to take the collateral, to decide on where to make, you know, who can qualify for the loan, to decide how much is needed to address the money market problems and so on. And we're totally protected that way. Now, we're protected also in discount window through collateral, but I think this is a better way to do it.
Lastly, and very quickly, we've established, I think you've got the ability to lend directly to domestic subsidiaries. You have the ability to do these swaps. But you told my colleague from South Carolina in December that you had neither the intention nor the authority to bail out European banks. Is that still, you still stand by that statement? You do not have the intention or the authority to do that?
So in that particular conversation, off-the-record conversation, I was asked, and I said, well, first of all, let me be clear. We've done these swaps, and I explained them to them, talked about them. So and they had been done well before that conversation. And then the question was, were we going to do additional things? Were we going to make loans to the IMF or something like that? And the answer is no.
Thank you, sir.
Ms. Wasserman Schultz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman Bernanke, it's good to see you. Our friends on the other side of the aisle, since the debate over the Recovery Act ensued, have furiously tried to insist that it had no impact, that it created no jobs, and that it wasn't necessary. According to CBO, the Recovery Act lowered the unemployment rate by up to 1.8 percentage points in calendar year 2010, up to 1.4 percentage points in 2011, relative to what it would have been had Congress not acted at all. Since that time, actually since 2005, we've created more jobs in last year than we have since 2005, and since March of 2010, 3.2 million jobs have been created in the private sector. So my question to you is, had we not acted and passed the Recovery Act, would that recovery happened as soon or even at all? And are there times, because Mr. Flores seemed to be pressing the notion that it is only private market investment that we should use to help an economy or a recession turn around, are there times when you think public investment like the Recovery Act is necessary?
Well, to answer your question directly, as you say, the CBO calculated some effects on GDP and employment. Obviously, that requires some assumptions about the counterfactual, what would have happened otherwise, but the Fed is, in our analysis, in our modeling, we're basically pretty comfortable with the CBO's conclusions. We think it did have some positive effects on growth and employment. So yes.
Thank you. Then just shifting gears, there's also been a pretty raging debate over the course of the last year over what is the best way to reduce the deficit. Clearly we all share the goal of reducing the deficit as significantly and as quickly as possible. Would you agree, though, because our friends on the other side of the aisle believe and have tried to enact only spending cuts that they deem wasteful as a strategy towards deficit reduction, would you agree that wasteful spending also exists and is created in the tax code?
Well, I think you're pushing me into areas which are the province of Congress. I think what the law that I would support is the law of arithmetic. So if you are, if you believe that the government should be doing more and spending more, then you should be willing to collect the taxes to do that. And if you want to cut taxes and keep revenues low, then you have to find the spending cuts that match that. So what I think that balance is what's critical. People have different visions of what the role of government should play, and I don't think I'm the one to adjudicate that. Clearly, that's a big issue.
No, and I know, and I'm not asking you to make a political judgment because that's our job. But CBO, would you agree with CBO, who has said that tax cuts, like the 2001-2003 tax cuts for the wealthiest, provide the least bang for our buck in terms of job creation and reducing unemployment?
I think that's a debatable point. They provide some demand from the point of view of putting more income in people's pockets. I think the other issue, though, is to ask the question of how do they play into the long-run efficiency of the tax code. haven't talked about it much today, but I think there would be a lot of benefit without much budgetary cost of thinking about our corporate and personal income tax codes and improving those, reducing inefficient exemptions, broadening the base, and so on. So from a purely demand side perspective, tax cuts do provide income, do provide source of spending. They may be less in some cases than spending in a purely demand side perspective, but you also have to think about the role of the tax code in promoting growth in the long term.
And just one other quick question before my time expires. Would you say that deficit finance tax cuts tend to pay for themselves?
No, except in very rare circumstances. I don't think many people, including many good friends of mine on both sides of the aisle, would argue tax cuts fully pay for themselves. The question is whether or not they improve efficiency and growth, but not whether they fully pay for themselves.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you. Mr. Young.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Dr. Bernanke, for visiting with us today. Clearly, this economic recovery has been long delayed. It remains fragile. My constituents are frustrated, as are so many of us serving them, that we're not doing some things here on the fiscal side of the ledger to get the economy moving more quickly. 2011, real GDP growth was 1.7%. Private sector forecasts indicate that in the coming year, we're going to be at 2.2%. That is well below the 3% growth that trends recent history. We have a jobs deficit, 8.6 million jobs lost in the 2008-09 recession, less than a third of those recovered. I'm really concerned about our country tipping back into recession at this point, maybe as a result of Europe. We spent some time discussing Europe here today in your interaction with ECB officials and others. But what I'd like to hear from you, Doctor, is what preparation our Fed has made for a disorderly default by Greece or some of these other countries within Europe. I haven't heard any specifics there. You have indicated that the Fed was prepared to use all the different levers that you have, all policy options. So that's the general question. But specifically, I'd also like you to speak to the money market mutual fund market. Right after Lehman, there was a bailout of the money market mutual funds because of panic over so-called breaking the buck. That is, the investment income wouldn't cover all operating expenses. It wouldn't cover all the investment losses. And so there was an intervention by the United States into that market. Could that also be something that people begin demanding right here in Washington? We bail out the money markets as a result of a disorderly default in Europe.
So in terms of preparations, other than beyond the swaps, which we just discussed, the Federal Reserve has been operating as in a supervisory capacity, working with other bank supervisors to understand the exposures of banks to European nations, to European banks, European economies, trying to help them manage the risks and reduce the risk wherever possible. We've been doing that. The other set of tools that we have in the event of a crisis, which I think would, if it was severe enough, would have very adverse effects for our economy and our financial system, no matter how well prepared we are, is the modified 13.3 authorities that Dodd-Frank left us. We can, of course, first use the discount window, as we always do, as a backstop liquidity provision for banks that come under pressure from funders. And if necessary, we could use the 13.3 authority to provide additional programs to lend to other institutions that are under funding pressure. So we would try to mitigate the any resulting contagion from problems in the banking sector or in the economies of Europe. We pay close attention to money market mutual funds. Of course, the SEC is the primary regulator there. They too, like our banks, have been working to reduce their exposure to Europe. They have substantially reduced their exposure to the Eurozone countries. and all that's to the good.
If I could interject briefly, is there a reason why the Financial Stability Oversight Council created by Dodd-Frank to monitor systemic risk has not characterized the money market mutual funds as a systemic risk in this case?
Well, I think it did actually in July. It did point to money market mutual funds as an area that needed more work. You mentioned the bailout, the things that were done in 2008, such as the Treasury using the Exchange Stabilization Fund to guarantee money market mutual fund deposits were outlawed by Dodd-Frank, and so those things aren't available. So it's very important that the money market mutual funds take the necessary actions to be safe in the event of some kind of problem. As I said, one thing they're doing is reducing their risk and their exposures, but the SEC, which has already imposed some improvements in the regulation of these funds, is considering additional steps and consulting with the Federal Reserve, and we are quite sympathetic to the idea that more might need to be done in order to ensure that we don't see another run like we did in 2008.
I'll yield back my remaining 2 seconds. Thank you.
Mr. Rokita.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Mr. Chairman, thanks for coming back again. It's good to talk to you. As I said yesterday to the other witness, it's about this time in the day that we always seem to talk to each other and trying to synthesize everything that's been said. I have a few, several distinct questions, and if we can be succinct in our answers as much as possible. You may have repeated it, and if so, just say so. You may be repeating it, and if so, just say so. First of all, this discussion about the inflation, and we talked about this the last time we talked via microphone here. When you say you're not worried about the increase in inflation, my layman's way of looking at this is that when you're effectively printing money through the quantitative easing and the money's piling up, the inflation may be measured by the lack of velocity or velocity when that money changes hands. And so it's my perception that the banks are holding onto the money because to make sure the sheet's balanced for the regulators and for fiscal soundness. People might be stuffing money in their mattress because they're so uncertain or putting it somewhere. They're not using the money. And aren't you worried that when we get this government believing again, for example, in a true free market system, and people start having confidence and the money starts picking up velocity, aren't you worried that you're not going to be able to stop that runaway train?
No, we're not concerned. We have two broad sets of tools to remove the money at the appropriate time. One is simply to sell assets, which extinguishes the money. The other is to use a variety of tools we've developed to sterilize or essentially remove that, either lock up or remove those excess reserves in the banking system. So at the time that comes, we have to raise interest rates to fight inflation. We've made explicit what our inflation goal is now, 2%. The markets seem very confident in our forecasts. Private sector forecasters, even surveys of consumers all feel that inflation is well controlled and will be well controlled, and we do have the tools to withdraw that money.
Thank you, Chairman. Many baby boomers are retiring. We know 10,000 per day. It traditionally has been the strategy to have the more elderly in our society be able to rely on less riskier investments, like bond interest income, things like that. And it seems with the interest rates so low that we may be forcing our most vulnerable citizens into more riskier investments. Do you have a comment on that?
Well, I did talk about it before. We do take into account. We understand it's an issue for many people. That being said, our savers collectively have to hold all the assets in the economy, and a strong economy produces much better returns in general.
Fair enough. Kevin Warsh was a former Federal Reserve governor, sure you know. He wrote an article in the Wall Street Journal December 6th, 2011, and I'm just, if you don't mind, quote from it and then have you comment on it. However well-intentioned, the Federal Reserve's continued purchase of long-term Treasury securities risk camouflaging the country's true cost of capital. Private investors are crowded out of the market when the Fed shows up as a large and powerful bidder.
Private investors are not being crowded out. They have the best access to capital they've had in a long time at low interest rates. Bond markets are open. I think the people who have trouble are small businesses and others who can't access bank credit to the extent we would like.
And then you mentioned Canada earlier on, and you indicated that they had less of a recession than we did. Why do you think that is?
Well, the main reason, there were several reasons, but the main reason I think is that they have a small number of large banks, which has pluses and minuses, but in this case, they had probably better regulation. The banks didn't get involved in subprime mortgages and the like. And so some of the things that created our housing boom and bust and our financial crisis were not as severe there, and that's why they didn't have as deep a recession.
Would you personally favor a model more like Canada's in terms of quote-unquote better regulations?
Well, I don't think I want to go to just a small number of large banks. I think community banks and medium-sized banks play an important role in our economy, but I think they were right in being tougher and making sure that banks were not taking excessive risks. Our system is much more complicated, and therefore some of the steps that have been taken to provide a more systemic or macro-oriented approach, I think, are a plus here, and was less necessary in Canada with a slightly less complicated financial system.
And finally, if you had to choose between one of the mandates, which would you rather pursue?
Please answer the question.
You said you had subpoena power, was that right?
Yeah.
Well, ultimately, of course, central banks, in the long run, they only control inflation. So obviously, price stability is a critical function of central banks. That provides a healthier economy in the long term. You know, that being said, in the short term, I think that some benefits can be had in terms of supporting a weak recovery like the one we have now.
I thank both chairmen.
Ms. Black, will you yield for just a moment?
Sir?
To tack on to what Mr. Rakita is saying, with this new statement, we know there were deliberations whether or not to have an employment mandate, and that's not in there, but you referenced specifically 5.2 to 6%. In the next paragraph, you talk about focusing on deviations. We have an incredible, unprecedented expansion of the monetary base. And so when velocity turns back on, that's when paying higher interest on reserves must occur to sop up the money supply, which is your plan. Mm-hmm. But I would argue that this is made more complicated now, less certain from us as to whether that's going to occur on time, because what if the employment deviation is greater than the inflation deviation at that time? And with that kind of monetary base running through a system with faster velocity, it's like putting a cruise missile through goalposts. I mean, the question is, are you going to do this? I mean, are you going to be able to mop it up on time now that you have, you know, perceptively more emphasis based on the employment mandate? And that's why these things are made more ambiguous in our
No, I'm sure we can do it. We have the technical ability, of course, as always.
Sure you have to.
As always, you know, in any situation, there's always the question of whether or not you tighten too early or too late, but that's a judgment you always have to make. But in terms of technically, we have no difficulty in doing it. I'd point out that the Bank of England and the ECB, both of which are single mandate banks, currently have larger balance sheets than we do as a share of GDP.
I hope you're right.
Yeah.
Ms. Black.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Bernanke, for being here and giving us so much time. I want to turn to your testimony on page 6. And because I'm a visual learner, I did a little diagram here that helps me to work through what you're saying here. And I think you make some very good points. And you start out by saying in that second full paragraph that having a large and increasing level of government debt relative to national income runs the risk of serious economic consequences. So I start out here with increased debt, and then I go down here with what you say it is. It crowds out private capital. And then, therefore, reduces productivity growth, which then results in more borrowing, i.e. from foreign governments from abroad, which then increases our future income devoted to interest payments, which then comes back full circle to increasing the amount of debt. So I think that cyclical piece there is in a diagram really would help my constituents to see how this is so important that we take care of this issue. Mm-hmm. But I'm also intrigued by your results that you say here impairs the ability of the policymakers to respond effectively to future shocks or adverse events, which is our role and our responsibility. Then ultimately, unsustainable deficits increase the possibility of sudden fiscal crisis, which, as we look at what's happened in Europe, certainly can happen here. I think you've diagrammed that well for us. Mm-hmm. And then finally, my point is that you make here investors lose confidence, in the ability of the government to manage its fiscal policy. So the fiscal policy piece of that is our role and responsibility. Would you agree that the economic growth flows from investments and savings in the long term and not borrowing? We can agree with that?
Well, it's got to be. Sometimes you have savers who want to provide funds to invest. If you're a firm and you're a startup firm, you don't have enough of your own money to invest, and you've got savers over here, then borrowing could be part of the process by which the money from the savers goes to the investors. So I don't think you want to get rid of borrowing in general, mortgages or help people own homes, et cetera. But certainly from the federal point of view, if borrowing is so large that the deficit relative to the size of the economy continues to grow, then that feedback loop you were talking about, higher interest rates, bigger deficits, bigger debt, is a significant concern, and bond markets can bring that forward. Anticipation of that can bring that forward. So if your question is, should the federal government have a long-term plan to keep its fiscal situation sustainable and stable, obviously the answer is yes.
Okay, so that given, then can you help me with how do the policies of the Fed on setting the interest rates affect the investors and the savers?
Well, my comment a moment ago about the about investors having access to capital, currently the economy is not in a recession, but it's far from full employment. And so there's plenty of unused resources available to be put to work by firms. And we're not seeing any evidence that either monetary or fiscal policy is crowding out private sector activity. To the contrary, to the extent that we can support growth and lower rates for borrowers, we can we can facilitate investment spending. But clearly, when the economy is at full employment, deficits raise interest rates and they therefore reduce investment. Monetary policy, which is too easy, distorts the economy and leads to inflation pressures. So clearly it's a function of where the economy is.
Well, and on the other end, does a zero interest rate encourage savers to save?
It may, because there's both what economists call substitution effects and income effects. You may need to save more in order to get the same return. But
I'm not sure that for me, and maybe I'm just abnormal, but I'm not sure that putting my money into accounts where I'm going to get a zero return is probably what I want to do, especially in an economy that is so uncertain.
So let's just think this through. Suppose in order to solve savers' problems, suppose the Fed raised interest rates sharply. That would almost certainly throw the economy back into recession. It would mean stock market would decline. It would mean returns on other investments would go down. And it might mean that increased deficits might lead to more concerns about our federal government. So, we understand the concern that savers have, but we're trying to deal with a bad situation, and this is one of the tools we have to try to get the economy back to full employment.
I know my time is out, but I'm not advocating a sharp increase. I'm just saying that there is not an incentive there right now if there's 0% interest. Thank you.
Yeah, there is a case for normalizing policy. I think that's Mr. Langford.
Chairman, thank you for being here very much, and I also appreciate your open communication that you've started, more press conferences, more communication. Anytime you get the Federal Reserve ideas and thoughts out there, it's obviously helpful, and I know that's part of your strategy as well, so I appreciate you taking that on, allowing some more sunshine into your thoughts and the plans here. You mentioned earlier about small business access to capital, and that is a concern, and that's something we actually talked about last time that you were here. And the fact that you'd mentioned bank examiners are becoming more conservative in this time of instability, and that is an issue. I can tell you in community banks that I deal with, and I represent Oklahoma, community bankers are still very concerned with the, the approach on compliance. Safety and soundness, they have no issue with. Compliance becomes a big issue, and especially with the number of rules that are coming down now and the number of regulations. Let me just give you one example. The new Volcker rule that was intended to only affect big banks, our community banks have to prove that they're exempt from it. And so you've got a bank of 40 people, total employees, going through pages and pages and pages of documents to prove they don't apply to this. It's adding a tremendous amount of workload that is not into lending, and that is forcing them to second guess. When we talked about this last year, you said there's been some modest improvements on that. I'd like to follow up and say, what improvements can we still expect in the coming days? Because the community bankers that I talked to still are not actively lending and are still second guessing every bit of risk, not sure if someone's going to come in and second guess them.
So I won't go into the safety and soundness part because your question was about compliance.
Right.
So it is certainly true that many of the provisions of Dodd-Frank are aimed at the biggest banks, and the small banks, you know, it's irrelevant to them. And I agree with you that they should be spared even the need to demonstrate to their small banks. We know they're small banks.
But they currently do have to demonstrate it.
So what we're doing at the Fed, we have a subcommittee of two governors, Governor Duke, who was a community banker, and Governor Raskin, who was besides being a Senate staff person, was also the head of supervision in Maryland. So they're both very knowledgeable about small banks. And their job, working with staff, is to try to first make sure that rules that don't apply to small banks are not put in force, and that in addition to that, that we provide as much clarity as we can to what the small banks need to worry about, what part they can just throw away. To help us on that, we have created an advisory council of community depository institutions that we meet with and get their feedback. You know, I appreciate your point, and I think it's progress that we're moving away from the safety and soundness issue, but we are working on that.
Do you feel like it's getting better in the next year? Because my community bankers that I'm talking to are getting more frustrated, and to them it's death by 1,000 paper cuts.
Right.
It's not any one single piece, it's just the frequency of how many small pieces are coming at them, and with the bank, again, 35, 40 people in total employees, they cannot keep up with the frequency of things that are coming.
We've already begun a process whereby we will try to provide instructions, guidance to smaller banks about what part they can just throw away without looking at it.
Okay. That'd be very helpful to continue to press on that. And I know you're attentive. Obviously, that's the highest number of banks that we have out there, mm-hmm. Not the highest systemic risk, but they're getting the brunt of a lot of this.
Sure.
Separate question for you, and it's a broader issue that I personally struggle with in trying to watch across the world. We have so much sovereign debt worldwide. And we're continuing to add more and more sovereign debt worldwide. At what point do we reach the definition of unsustainable worldwide, that we reach some kind of limit where we don't have enough liquid capital sitting out there for all the borrowing that's happening in all the sovereigns, not just us? Obviously, we're the largest of that. Mm-hmm. But there has to be some point that would be defined as unsustainable. There's not enough liquid capital to manage this, and we are pulling it out of the markets, and we've hit that cycle.
Well, at the moment, private borrowing is way down because of the weakness of the economy. So there's money out there. As we get to full employment, then you're going to start seeing the crowding out, that people are going to have to pay higher rates, and that's going to have the adverse effects I discussed on capital formation and productivity. I do think, though, that from our perspective in the United States, I think we are the premier economy, we are the safe haven. We have a strong interest in maintaining that status. So I guess I'd worry less about the global supply of capital and just really think about managing our own need for capital going
forward. Sure, I understand that, but there's a limited amount of liquid capital at any moment worldwide, and every country is competing for it at a higher rate.
Well, so
it's accelerating.
There's a supply and demand, so interest rates will go up until supply equals demand, but so the money will be there in some sense, but if the rate is so high, that'll be bad both for the fiscal borrowers and for the private sector.
But that would be the definition of unsustainable, that we suddenly cannot get the money at the rate that we need it for in other countries, and obviously that affects us. And
that's right.
The contagion begins. The sense is, are we even close to that kind of point? I mean, that's predicting, that's crystal ball type stuff, but you've got to be watching that as well.
Well, again, for countries like the United States and the UK and others, rates remain very low, government bond rates. The bond market is very forward-looking. I mean, a lot of the bonds are 30 years, right? So a lot of this depends on what the bond markets expect the sovereign financing needs to be over the next few decades. And so once again, it's really, to some extent, a country-by-country issue. If we can take a strong set of policies to ensure the sustainability of our fiscal situation, I'm sure that that the funding for the United States will be there.
Thank you. You're back.
Queue is closed. Last question, Mr. Huelskamp.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Dr. Bernanke, I appreciate your time today and remember our discussions last year. And one thing I asked my staff in the last few days to read through transcripts, the 2006 Federal Open Market Committee meetings, and looking at those comments and the transcripts, is it fair to say that the Fed did not see the severity of the housing crisis coming in 2006?
I think I think the mistake was a little different than that. House prices were already falling in 2006, and we were aware of that. What we didn't know was what was the impact going to be, and in particular, we didn't have a sufficient understanding of how the fall in house prices, the resulting effects on mortgage quality, and so on would affect the financial system. That was the linkage that we didn't see in 2006. So yes, we didn't see the crisis coming, but we certainly were aware in 2006 that the housing market was cooling, and we talked about that quite frequently, and I talked about it in testimony. I have to emphasize that we've learned a lot of lessons from that experience, and we have radically changed the way we do our supervision, and also in particular, we now focus very much on the interactions between different parts of the system, looking at it from a systemic point of view, not just from individual institutions. So while I can never promise that we won't have another financial crisis, I think we have made a lot of progress in our ability to monitor those situations.
And Mr. Bernanke, looking at the economic projections from last January, if I have the right ones here, you projected growth of 3.4 to 3.9% for GDP for this past year. It came in at 1.7. What happened, and why were you so far off, and what kind of expectations do you have that will you potentially be that far off in for your projections for the coming year?
I'd like to look at those numbers. I don't recall what our projection was, but there were, I would say, two classes of things. One is that there was some developments that were impossible to anticipate, like the tsunami in Japan and its implications for global supply chains and the like, or the effects of the Arab Spring on oil prices, a few things like that. But I think more generally, it is fair to say that since the recession ended, that we have, until recently at least, been too optimistic about the pace of recovery. And as I go back and look at the reasons for it, I think the two main areas I would point to, one is the housing sector, which I've talked about today, which has not recovered the way we had hoped and expected, and continued pressure in financial markets, part of which is related to Europe, which again, we didn't fully anticipate in 2010.
But you believe those factors were the primary reasons you were about 100% over the actual growth we achieved this last year, which was an anemic 1.7%. Again, these are your figures. 3.4 to 3.9% was the range. You projected for 2012 3.5 to 4.4%, and now you're back, I guess, more reality, you're projecting roughly 2% growth. That's pretty far off and pretty rosy, and we sat in this room here and thought we had some difficulties. I'm just concerned with how comfortable and confident you are on how long we'll stick at the 2% growth.
Macroeconomic forecasting is very difficult. We don't pretend that we are have a crystal ball. What we try to do is set our projections at a level where we think the chances of being too optimistic or roughly equal to the chances of being too pessimistic. So we'll see what happens.
I understand. That's the range.
We could be better than we expect.
Yeah. Well, I would hope it would be. But seeing those figures that have been talked about earlier, how we have such an anemic recovery, the worst one since the war, we're 13.7 million jobs short of where we would be on an average recovery. And from your estimates, I have not seen that coming out that is getting that flavor for that. One other thing I want to mention about the transcripts, and others have talked about thanking you for being a big supporter of transparency, but is there a reason you have to wait 5 years to release transcripts of your meetings for transparency purposes?
Well, that was the agreement that was made with Congress. I think it was a reasonable compromise. No other central bank virtually releases transcripts ever. The Bank of Japan does after a 10-year lag.
As far as we're aware, no other government agency releases the transcripts of confidential meetings. It has a real cost to our deliberation process. When the transcripts were begun to be released, the meetings became much more scripted, much less free interchange. So I think it would inhibit the discussion process and the free exchange of ideas. Five years seems to us to be an appropriate compromise. It certainly satisfies the needs of history. And again, it's a more aggressive, transparent policy than other agencies or other central banks.
And Mr. Chairman, if I might, 15 more seconds just to close on that comment.
Go fast.
Thank you, Doctor. I appreciate this, but this is America, and we are responsible for fiscal policy, and the impact, particularly the proposals you have made on housing policy, suggest an incredibly bigger role than in other countries. So I appreciate the transparency. I wish we'd step that up so the American people feel more comfortable with decisions that have been made. So thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Chairman, you've indulged us for 2.5 hours. Appreciate your patience, and the hearing is adjourned.
Thank you.